Grace to you and peace in the name of God, who is our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer. It is my joy to proclaim that whoever you love, you are welcome here. Whatever your gender identity or expression, you are welcome here. Whatever your race or ethnicity, you are welcome here. If your pockets feel full or empty, if your heart feels full or empty, if you came today on fire with faith, or if you came tiptoeing over wondering if you really belong, come and know the love of God, which is for all people. Come and know the love of God, which binds us together as a community and sends us out to show love and courage to an aching world. Come and let us be the church together. If you are new or reconnecting to this community today, hello and welcome. We are so glad you are here. If at some point you're feeling brave, there is a new visitor form available in the video description. And through that, you can sign up for our emails, and we as the pastors would love just to reach out and get to know you a little. I heard that there's something happening this week. It is Christmas Eve is coming up, and we are delighted for having so many different ways that we are gathering to worship this season. If you will be joining us for in-person worship, there are online signups available for both the 4:30 and 10 p.m. services. And we appreciate using that so that we can get more of a sense of who will be joining us as we gather for Christmas Eve. And if you're going to be continuing to join us online, wonderful. We are going to be having two online viewings, one at 4:30 and one at 10. And both of these will be the same service, so you can choose when fits best in your celebrations as we gather together to worship. You're strongly encouraged, if you have any candles, to try to have them with you as we worship this Christmas Eve. In person, we'll have them. Virtual, it's hard to send through the screen. And as well, I want to let you know that immediately following the postlude today, we are going to be having an encore performance of our Christmas pageant from last year involving the children and youth of the church. And so if you need something to fill your heart, we hope you can stay after the postlude today. Phew. And so with that, let's take a moment and be in a spirit of God together this morning.
Good morning. I'm Catherine Blackley, speaking to you today as the chair of the Outreach Committee. I want to let you know that this is the second and final week of our December special offering. Our three recipients for this offering are LifeWire, the UCC Christmas Fund, and Northwest Harvest. LifeWire supports local people of all ages who have been impacted by domestic violence. The UCC Christmas Fund provides financial support for active and retired clergy and lay employees of the United Church of Christ. Northwest Harvest is a major hunger relief organization in our state, focusing on both food distribution and advocacy. Contributions will be shared evenly among these recipients. There are a few ways that you can choose to donate. You can donate online at our website by selecting December Special Offering from the drop-down menu. Or you can mail or bring in a check with December Special Offering in a memo line. Thank you for supporting these organizations this Advent season.
On this fourth Sunday of Advent, if you could be any member of the Nativity story, who would you choose? Well, today, we are spending some time with Joseph and how he answered a call, maybe not to the center, but to support the work that God was doing in something new. Come, let us worship our God.
Let me open my hand. Let me open my heart.
God of the heights and depths, as we light this candle of joy, kindle in us a hint of your deep joy in the world. We may feel happy and sad at times, but beneath it all is the joy in your goodness and presence in the world. In the midst of the difficult parts of this season, may you meet us in flickers of joy. As we prepare for the coming of Christ, may we whisper your joy into the shadowed night. Amen.
God of joy, we seek the joy of your presence, whether walking in the shadows or in the light. God of joy, we seek the joy of your presence. In so many places we see misery and pain. God of joy, we seek the joy of your presence. Prepare us to recognize the star of your birth, the paths leading to the embodiment of your love, the community which surrounds you. God of joy, we seek the joy of your presence. Prepare us to receive your love, joy, and assurance just when we need it most. God of joy, we seek the joy of your presence. May your joy fill our hearts and grace our lips, so that we might reflect your joy to all the world. God of joy, we seek the joy of your presence. On this fourth week of Advent, let us remember that the good news of Jesus' birth has the power to bring us great joy during all the seasons of our lives. God, who has come to fulfill the prophecies of old, to right the injustices suffered by the oppressed, to live and teach a way of life embodied by love, we seek the joy of your presence. Help us to remember that our joy is connected to your presence in our lives and not to the external. God of all nations, bearer of hope, peace, love, and joy, we thank you for sending Jesus to come and dwell among us. We thank you for his example, his teachings, his sacrifice, his victory over death. God of joy, we claim the joy of your presence. We ask that you flood our hearts with joy this Advent season as we reflect upon the news of Jesus' birth. It is in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen.
Reading from Matthew 1, verses 18 to 25. Now this is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah happened. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to have a child in her womb from the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, was a just man, and unwilling to shame her, he wanted to divorce her secretly. But when he deliberated this, suddenly an angel of the Most High God appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for in her is conceived a child from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this happened to fulfill what had been spoken by the Most High God through the prophet. "Look now, the virgin shall conceive a child in her womb and give birth to a son, and they shall call him Emmanuel," which translated means "God is with us." When Joseph got up from sleep, he did as the angel of the Most High God commanded him. He took her as his wife, yet he did not know her sexually until her birthing of a son, and named him Jesus.
Thank you.
So about a decade ago at a former church, I was in charge of a Christmas pageant, which was, to put it lightly, a big deal. It was a town tradition held on Christmas Eve with a script that hadn't been changed in decades, just as a point of continuity amidst the chaos of all of its participants. Because every year, there was somewhere between 70 and 80 participants in this Christmas pageant, which meant that we needed a dozen magi, a remarkable number of shepherds, and enough small angels that, well, let's put it this way, having an angel parent to keep the blessed cherubs in line was a must. For this pageant, we had a few main parts and many years of tradition. So for Mary, for many years, had been a high school senior girl. And this was a role that was much sought after. There was one year that we split the role because a decision would have been too difficult. So we had two Marys, one for the start and one for the end of the production. And for that same year, two sets of families had volunteered their infants to be baby Jesus. So we had two baby Jesus, or as we referred to them that year, baby Jesus. So I was in charge of the production side. And so I spent most years around Christmas trying to corral props and expectations. So I was telling parents, yes, your kid can be an angel. We have the halo. If you can just find something white to wear because we're out of Christmas ropes. And it was also my job every year to find a Joseph. If every other role in the production was highly sought after, even King Herod, who had a nice laugh line, finding Joseph was a challenge. Traditionally, it was also a high school senior, and this time a boy most of the time. But unlike Mary, Joseph had no lines. And he was also not responsible for holding the aforementioned baby Jesus. It was not easy to find a Joseph. If casting the rest of the production was holding back the hordes of volunteers and expectations, finding a Joseph was like asking a favor for a job no one wanted. One year, I asked one high school senior who said no, and another senior who said no, and the third one that I asked said he was so sorry, but he'd just broken his leg. And so that meant there's no way he could be Joseph. I finally found a younger student who was willing to say yes, bless him. Because although this was a role without lines and without moments in the spotlight, it was crucial, important, and we couldn't tell the story without it. All of which feels rather fitting for our story today, because I wonder if it took some work for the angel to convince Joseph that his call, his task, wasn't like he pictured it to be. He wasn't going to be the star. He wasn't going to be the hero in the center of the story. His call was deeply important, and his call was in the background. In the scripture for today, Mary and Joseph are in a tragic and difficult moment. As the scripture said, as they were engaged, but before they came together, with the Bible and its euphemism. At this time, engagement is a legal contract. And to break it is something similar to divorce. And so here they are, engaged, have not come together, and Mary is pregnant. And Joseph knows he is not the biological father. Joseph may have had a plan, a dream like many men of his time. He might have had a dream of being great and important and having his manliness affirmed by the coming of his own children. Beginning of generations, being the head of a family and a leader of importance to provide. As a carpenter, Joseph would have been a tradesperson, not a scribe or a priest. And I wonder what stories Joseph hoped people might tell about him, and what anxieties he held about how he was perceived. I wonder about the words he might be afraid of being called, a fool, a laughingstock, a loser, the words that the world would use for Mary, which are harsher skill. And I don't know for certain, but I'm willing to guess he thought he would be the main character of his life. And so, at the beginning of this, the options that he's weighing are between dismissing Mary quietly or publicly. Pretty much between relegating Mary into a realm of financial and social ruin, or ruin with the threat of violence, as stoning is technically an option. And as the story says, he's weighing how people would see him, whether he should dismiss her publicly to show how affronted he was in his honor, or dismissing her quietly to be just and noble. And still beneath that, for Joseph, we can imagine his anger and the feelings that anger can only mask of sadness and betrayal and vulnerability or despair. And we can imagine what would feed on these fears amidst the night of restless sleep. And yet, instead, it is a different dream that meets Joseph. An angel of the Lord appears to him in a dream and calls him by name, Joseph, son of David. Do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. You are to name him Jesus, for he shall save the people from our sins. And after quoting scripture, disappears. In the midst of the night, Joseph has a vision, and that vision calls him from his fears and gives him a glimpse of something he wouldn't have imagined. That, you know, God is breaking the rules he has known for how babies are made. And that God is doing something incredible. Becoming Emmanuel, God with us. And that Joseph has been called at this moment not to be a biological father, but to be a parent to a child, Jesus. So if in the nighttime, Joseph went to bed trying to decide between plan A, dismissing Mary quietly, and plan B, going through a whole public trial, and there in the darkness, God reveals to him plan Q. Takes his pro-con list and sets it on fire to heat up the plan that God is cooking for the transformation of all mankind. And so what is God doing here, saying your contribution to this new reality will not be from biology, but from relationship? Marrying the one who is carrying Christ. Even today, Joseph does not emerge for us as a conquering hero at the center of the scene. If you say Joseph in the Bible, you'd be within your rights to say, which one was that? And instead, Joseph has the crucial part of the supporting cast, depicted as caring for mother and child, discerning from dreams, leading to the safety, caring for his wife and the Christ child. While Mary is the one with a voice and says yes, and Christ with us is the one in the center of the scene. In our world and time, we know in our midst there are those who are trained from birth to be at the center of the story, and those who are expected to be the supporting cast. We know in terms of gender that those who have been identified as female are often expected to be those cheering from the sidelines or the woman behind the man. We know in terms of race that often the movie has the lead character who is white and a person of color who is the best friend and gives heartfelt advice. And in the broader world, part of the brokenness is that in the power structures of what stories matter, of what compassion makes a difference, of whose opinions and thoughts are given the most weight, the heroes of our stories most often match the broken values of our world for their straight cisgender whiteness that is ready to step into the spotlight that is used to it. And so if God is telling a different kind of story, sometimes that's changing how the cast of characters might be portrayed. For those who have been on the margins, often the way God changes the powers of the world is by inviting those on the margin to the center, to speak, to lead, to shift the narrative in a new way, and to create a new reality. And for those who frequently have found themselves thrust in the center, I wonder what it would be to look at Joseph in a new way. If there's an important part of the story to hold that isn't the center. I know that for me, there are many times that I want to be faithful and to serve God. And if I were honest, I have a pretty good idea of what I think I should do, what that service might look like, and how ego and what I would like mean I'm really ready to serve God in a way that happens to also coincides with what I wanted to do anyway, or what my wider culture acclaims for me. Even if the culture is broken, and I know it, and I can say I hold a place of power and privilege in it, it can take a moment, a revelation, to say, maybe the way you're called looks different. It also is of God to say, this is a wide cast. I am called sometimes to a supporting role because we need to be able to hear the brilliant song of those who have been cast on the margins for too long. And for me in particular, as I keep learning over and over again in a season of disability, sometimes being faithful does not mean leading from the center. So I would maybe commend to you this. if immaculate conceptions are a miracle that you struggle with, I commend this one to you. That Mary's voice echoed for generations when the powers of the world would have had her silence in shame. And that Joseph married Mary with love, knowing that the child was not biologically his, but was now part of his family. Breaking all the rules and customs of the time, he cast his lot with the unmarried mother-to-be against the fates and powers of empires. And it was unto this surprising family that God joined us, came to us, revealed something new. So tell me again how we can create surprising families of love, claiming one another as kin, whatever the powers of the day have to say about it. Tell me again how it is through the witness of the poor young women that our salvation will be made real. Tell me again how we get to play second fiddle or 14th oboe in the opus that God is writing of liberation and justice. Tell me again how we can let go of our plans and ambitions because they're too small, and I want to learn how to choose plan Q. And see the beauty of the cast list when it's thrown out of order. Because dreams are so much better when they come from God. May we be ready to answer the call that we didn't expect of God, even with our broken leg. Amen. May the grace of God be with you in the worlds in which you live. May you be nurtured by the time of gathering and be faithful in the time apart and love and serve one another in the name of the faithful God who calls us to brand new roles to see what God might do. May the peace of God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer, be with us all the days of our life. Amen.